Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AS Academy. The list of topics chosen for today's discussion along with the page numbers is given here for your reference. Before starting today's news analysis, there is a good news. The India's Tiger Census sets a new Guinness World Record as world's largest camera trap wildlife survey. Yes, the 2018 Tiger Census got the Guinness World Record. A quick recap of 2018 Tiger Census. There are around 2,967 estimated tigers in India, which is around 75% of global tiger population. And this survey is the most comprehensive survey to date in both resource and data collected. Very importantly, know that the resolve of doubling tiger numbers under T+2 fulfilled much before the target year of 2022. And here is a question for you. According to 2018 census, which state is having the highest number of tigers? Post your answer in the comment section. This news article talks about a tweet by West Bengal governor urging the bureaucracy to act according to the All India Services Rules of 1968. So in this discussion, we shall see what is this All India Services Rules and other important terms like political neutrality, accountability, transparency, as well as code of conduct. The relevant syllabus is highlighted here for your reference. This topic assumes significance both in GS2 as well as GS4 papers. According to sources, the West Bengal governor was worried about rampant disregard and violations by the current government of West Bengal. It seems that the IAS and IPS officials are not complying with the orders of governor and are failing to generate the desired response. So the governor has urged the bureaucrats to maintain the political neutrality, accountability and transparency, and also to commit themselves for upholding the supremacy of the constitution. In short, they have been asked to follow the All India Services Rules of 1968. Know that these rules have been framed by the central government in accordance with All India Services Act of 1951. And very recently in 2014, these rules were amended for providing service conduct rules for bureaucrats. So this change, by including the service conduct or code of conduct rules, is regarded as one of the most important civil services reforms in the recent times. If you see, the transfer of bureaucrats is happening based on their political affiliations. Even many of bureaucrats were sent to prison or accused of corruption in a large number of alleged scams, depending on their affiliation to different political parties. So this mandated service conduct rules for bureaucrats. So these service conduct rules were inserted in 2014. And from then, the civil services are expected to maintain high ethical standards, integrity and honesty. In addition, they are supposed to maintain political neutrality or impartiality as well as accountability and transparency. Further, they have to commit themselves to the supremacy of constitution and uphold the same and democratic values. And there is one rule which outrightly prohibits every bureaucrat being associated with any political party or organization which takes part in politics. Simply, no bureaucrat should affiliate with any political organization. So based on this, the governor has made statements asking all the bureaucrats to commit themselves to the All India Services Rules. So in this context, we shall see what is political neutrality, transparency, as well as accountability. So firstly, what is meant by political neutrality? If you see, there is no perfect definition, but it can be simply defined as all the public servants must be neutral without supporting any political party. They must keep their jobs out of their politics and their politics out of their jobs. It also means that they should act impartially. That means not partial to any one section of people. If you see, these rules prevent a public servant from indulging in activities of political nature. And know that, like other citizens, public servant also has the right to vote. But he or she is expected to exercise it silently because his or her political beliefs should be the private concern and no one else needs to know about them. If you see, on the other hand, contradictingly, the public servant is under obligation to serve whichever political party is in power. So, a public servant is expected to serve under the political party in power, but he should not affiliate with the political party or he should not discriminate other parties. Simply, it can be put as governments come and go depending upon the wishes of the public. But the civil service, that is the steel frame, is permanent. This permanence of tenure encourages every public servant to serve impartially to whichever government is in power. So this is what is called political neutrality. Next, let us see what is accountability and transparency. In public administration, accountability refers to the obligation on the part of public servants to report on the usage of public resources and the obligation to be answerable for failing to meet the stated performance objectives. So accountability ensures that for every action and inaction of the government, there is a civil servant responsible and accountable to the government, civil society, and the public. For example, we know that a district collector has a wide-ranging powers. So he will be doing lot of works, he will be signing lot of projects. So for every project he approved or he rejected, he should be accountable for the decision he has made. Next, in public administration, transparency refers to unrestricted access to the public to the timely and reliable information on decisions made by the government. For example, whatever is happening in the government, the public has the right to know. Here, the government should maintain transparency by giving information to the public domain. For example, the right to information, wherein the government is expected to give all the details which are not sensitive to the national security to the public. So these values of transparency, accountability, along with integrity have been the dominant paradigm in public administration. These three are considered as the keystones of good governance. So in this manner, the transparency, accountability are important components of ethics infrastructure. So if all the public servants follow code of conduct, transparency, accountability, this lead to fair and reliable public services, predictable decision making, and creation of a level playing field for businesses. When all this happens, it improves the lives of poor and vulnerable. So this is all about this news article discussion. So this discussion will help you in both your GS2 as well as GS4 answer writing. So let us move on to next news article. Let us take up this news article, which talks about the opinion of former finance minister of Tamil Nadu about the Legislative Council. So in this context, let us discuss Legislative Council, its composition, its functions, and its position compared to Legislative Assembly. The relevant syllabus is highlighted here for your reference. Firstly, know that as of now, only 6 states have bicameral legislature. Bicameral means 2 chambers, assembly and council. They are Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Maharashtra, and Karnataka. So in a bicameral system, the state legislature consists of governor, council, and assembly. As we just said, only 6 states have 2 houses. So who has the power to create a legislative council for each state? This topic is discussed in Article 169 of Indian Constitution. So this article provides for creation as well as abolition of legislative councils. And this article empowers the parliament either to create or abolish a legislative council. But parliament can do this only if legislative assembly of a state passes a resolution either asking to create a council or to abolish a council. It means if state of Tamil Nadu wants a legislative council or to abolish a council, it has to pass a resolution. Only then the parliament can abolish or create a legislative council. Here two important things to note are, first one, the resolution in the state assembly either to create or abolish council must be passed by a special majority. Here special majority means majority of total membership of the house and a majority of not less than 2/3 of members who are present and voting. For example, assume that total membership of house is 100. So when we say a majority of total membership, it means at least 51 members should support the resolution. And out of 100, assume that 90 members are present and voting on that day. So out of 90, minimum 2/3, that is 60 members should support the resolution. So simply it means if there are 100 members in a house and out of which 90 are present and voting, at least 60 members should support the resolution either to create or abolish the legislative council. When such resolution is passed, then Parliament can consider making a change in constitution either to create or abolish the council. And very importantly, here note that the act of Parliament either to create or abolish is not considered to be an amendment under Article 368. So when we say the act of Parliament will not be considered under Article 368, it means the Parliament can make change with just an ordinary majority. So the State Assembly has to pass the resolution with special majority, while on the other hand, Parliament can make the change in the Constitution with just ordinary majority. So these are the two things you must be aware of for your prelims examination. Next, talking about the composition of Legislative Council, Article 171 says that the maximum strength of council is fixed at 1/3 of total strength of assembly and the minimum strength is fixed at 40. Suppose if the strength of assembly is 180, then the maximum strength of council can be 1/3 of 180, that is 60. However, the exact number is fixed by the Parliament. And know that the members of Legislative Council, that is MLCs, are indirectly elected through proportional representation system by single transferable vote, which is similar to the election to Rajya Sabha. And talking about the manner of election to Legislative Council, know that out of total members, 1/3 of membership is elected by members of local bodies like municipalities, district boards, etc. And 1/12 are elected by graduates, and another 1/12 are elected by teachers, and next 1/3 are elected by MLAs. Yes, 1/3 of members of Legislative Council are elected by MLAs, and remaining 1/6 is nominated by governor from amongst persons who have special knowledge or practical experience in literature, science, art, cooperative movement, and social service. Here you can relate this nomination of MLCs with nomination of Rajya Sabha members by the President. In Rajya Sabha, 12 members are nominated by the President who has the special knowledge or practical experience in matters like literature, science, art and social service. And in Legislative Council, the 1/6 of members are nominated by the Governor who has special knowledge in literature, science, art, cooperative movement and social service. Here the only change you have to keep in mind is there is one extra category called cooperative movement from where the members can be nominated to Legislative Council. And this category of cooperative movement is not available with reference to nomination of members in Rajya Sabha. And talking about the duration of Legislative Council, Article 172 says that the council is a permanent body and not subject to dissolution. But 1/3 of its members retire on the expiration of every second year. So a member continues as such for 6 years. And here importantly know that the retiring members are eligible for re-election and re-nomination any number of times. And here again, you can relate these provisions with Rajya Sabha. And finally, let us discuss the powers of council compared to assembly. Here Article 197 restricts the powers of council with respect to legislative assembly. First, we shall talk about ordinary bills. See, when an ordinary bill is passed by the assembly and sent to council, the council has 4 options. First one, it can simply pass the bill without any amendments. Second, it can pass the bill with amendments and return the bill to assembly for reconsideration of amendments. And third one, reject the bill altogether. And fourth one, keeping the bill pending without taking any action. If the assembly accepts the changes proposed by the council, the bill is deemed to have passed by the both the houses. But if the assembly rejects the amendments or if the council does not make any action for more than 3 months, then assembly can pass the bill once again. And if assembly passes the same bill once again and sends the same bill to council, now even if council rejects the bill or makes some amendments which are not acceptable to assembly, even then the bill is considered to be passed by both the houses. And one more possibility, that is if council does not take any action when bill is sent to the council for the second time within 1 month, even then the bill is deemed to have been passed by the both the houses. So it means the assembly has an upper hand with respect to council even in case of ordinary bills. At most, the council can hold the bill for 4 months, that is 3 months in the first instance and 1 month in the second instance. After the 4 months, the bill is considered to be passed by the both the houses. And coming to money bill, similar to the parliament, a money bill can be introduced only in the assembly and not in the council. And when this money bill is sent to the council, it cannot be amended or rejected. And council should return the bill to the assembly within 14 days, either with recommendations or without recommendations. And here note that assembly can either accept or reject all the recommendations made by the council. In both the cases, the money bill is said to be passed by the both houses. So from here you can understand that the legislative assembly has more power with respect to council, both in case of ordinary bills as well as money bills. So this is all about the legislative council, its composition and its position compared to legislative assembly. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of session. This news article discusses the keynote address delivered by the RBI governor. Though what he spoke in that meeting is not important in exam perspective, there are few important points which are considered to be very important in prelims perspective. In his speech, the governor has stressed the need for resolution corporation, and he also talked about the concept of bail-in and bail-out. So in this context, we shall discuss about resolution corporation, bail-in, bail-out and some of the important features of FRDI bill. The relevant syllabus is highlighted here for your reference. See, the RBI governor has said that the economic impact of the pandemic due to lockdown may result in higher non-performing assets and may also lead to capital erosion of banks. So simply he is saying that the lockdown is increasing the NPAs of banks. Further, he said that the shocks to the financial system, which were once called as once in a lifetime events, seem to be more frequent. This is because they are happening at least once in a decade. If you see, in 2009 we had a great recession where our banks took a severe beating in terms of NPAs, and now at the start of this year the S Bank had a crisis. And now there are many more crises which are going to come due to the pandemic imposed lockdown. So the RBI governor has said that the shocks to the system have become more frequent. So in this context, the governor also spoke about the lack of a mechanism to address these bank failures. See, every time we have seen in the news that if a bank becomes financially weak, it ends up being merged with a larger bank. So by merging a weak bank with a strong bank, the interests of depositors are protected, but it is going to affect the balance sheet of a large bank. So when we merge a small bank with a big bank, the small bank depositors are going to be benefited, but the large bank has to absorb the losses and issues of the small bank. So the large bank is going to be affected. But during the S Bank crisis, the Reserve Bank of India came up with a new resolution idea. See, after exhausting all possible options, RBI intervened and came up with S Bank reconstruction scheme. So instead of merging it with a larger bank, it proposed a public-private partnership between leading financial entities of India under the leadership of State Bank of India. So through this intervention, RBI was able to safeguard the interest of depositors, simultaneously ensuring the stability of financial system. To know more on S Bank reconstruction scheme, please refer 7th March, the Hindu News Analysis. But as we all know, RBI has many other important functions as well. So it cannot make itself busy with this reconstruction and resolution schemes. So this is why the RBI governor has stressed that a resolution corporation with a statutory backing is need of the hour. This is mainly to deal with the resolution and revival of stressed financial firms like S Bank. If you see, a resolution corporation was proposed in Financial Resolution and Deposit Insurance Bill of 2017. This resolution corporation is mandated to protect the consumers of banks for ensuring the stability and resilience of financial system. But this bill was not enacted due to concerns over a controversial bail-in clause. So from exam perspective, try to know the concept of bail-in. See, this bill specifies various tools to resolve a failing financial firm. For example, this include transferring its assets and liabilities, merging it with another firm, or altogether liquidating it. So one of these methods allow for cancellation or writing down of liabilities of the failing financial firm, or also restructuring its liabilities on a case-to-case basis. This method is known as bail-in. Here, when we tell liabilities, it involves everything the bank owes to others like depositors, creditors, etc. So what happens under bail-in is a portion of the liabilities of the bank are cancelled. So when these liabilities are cancelled, who are going to lose? Obviously, the depositors as well as creditors. So who deposited money in the bank are going to lose a portion of the amount or complete amount. So this is called bail-in clause. So this became a controversial and many people criticized this move by the government under FRDI bill. So what is bailout? See, bailout refers to infusion of funds, which means infusion of capital by external sources to resolve the financial firm. This includes a failing firm being rescued by the government as well. For example, if bank is having lot of liabilities and it is unable to pay its liabilities, then government can infuse some amount of capital to the bank, which can be used for paying off debts as well as liabilities. So you can see that in bail-in, the depositors and creditors will face losses, which is because the liabilities of the financial firm are cancelled. Whereas in bail-out, the depositors and creditors will not be at loss, since money is infused from external sources to revive the failing financial firm. So this bail-in clause was the reason that FRDI bill was not enacted. But now, as the RBI governor has insisted, it is time to have a resolution corporation. So government can legislate a resolution corporation by revisiting the controversial clauses of 2017 FRDI bill. With this, we come to end of the discussion of this news article, wherein we talked about the resolution corporation, the FRDI bill, the controversial clauses like bail-in as well as bail-out. Now let us move on to next news article. Next discussion is going to be based on these two news articles. Both news articles are related to the National Security Advisors. The first article is an interview with former NSA Shivshankar Menon, and the second article talks about the rise of the current NSA, who is Ajit Kumar Doval. So in this first news article, the former NSA talks about the Chinese strategy of intrusion. He starts by saying that Indo-China relations are getting more and more adversarial. He further says that the disengagement terms between India and China are dangerous. This is because these terms suggest that we are withdrawing from territory which we have controlled for a very long time. So by pulling out and suspending patrols along the LAC, it sends out the wrong message that both sides are equally responsible for the aggression. But in fact, we know that only China is responsible for the aggression. But by agreeing to pull out and suspending the patrolling across LAC, India is agreeing that it is also responsible for the aggression. The author also says that almost all China's military expeditions in Asia used the same strategy. For example, the Doklam standoff or recent China's claim to Bhutan's Sakteng Wildlife Sanctuary or even its claim on South China Sea. In all these cases, first China will claim a territory. Then there will be a standoff or tussle between China and the other country. This will be followed by some temporary peace agreement. But what happens is, the claim of China becomes permanent. This can also be said as taking two steps forward and negotiating one step backward. And in all these cases, China resorted in changing the facts on the ground. This is done by presenting the victim countries, for example India, with a fait accompli. It means presenting them with a history of agreement that no one heard of. Here China uses these agreements which no one heard of to claim territories by saying that these territories were historically part of China. And China projects these agreements during peace negotiations and makes it claim permanent. And further, author tells that China now sees India to be more strategically close to US. So it started showing more aggression towards India. This is mainly to show US that US cannot count India as an ally to counter China. This will also show our neighbors that if they want security from China, they cannot rely on India. So what are the solutions given by the author? Author says that India should solve the problems by self-strengthening. We should also strengthen our patrolling, our military capabilities, etc. We should also insist and force China to implement and respect the agreements which we already have. It includes respect for line of actual control and maintenance of status quo. India should also work closer with others who share our interests. For example, Indian neighbors, as well as Indian Ocean littoral countries and the Quad grouping, etc. At the same time, we should not forget the fact that China is one of our biggest trading partners. So to go aggressive or offensive against China, firstly, we should cut dependencies on China. It includes reducing Chinese presence in critical infrastructure and Indian market as well. But for this to happen, we should first boost our economy by strengthening the manufacturing sector and increasing employment and productivity. So these are the things discussed by the former NSA and assertions given in the current context of Indo-China border disputes. So this is all about the discussion of these news articles. The practice question will be discussed at the end of session. Let us move on to next news article. Let us take up this news article, which talks about a case in Supreme Court regarding the management of Padmanabha Swami Temple in Kerala. You might have heard about this temple, which is home to a lot of property. I mean, gold, silver, and other valuable items. So the Supreme Court is going to pronounce its judgment tomorrow. And this judgment is going to decide whether the state government or the erstwhile royal family will run the temple. And also the article mentions the terms like parens patriae, amicus curiae, etc. In this context, let us discuss these terms in brief. First, let us see amicus curiae. It literally means the friend of the court. So an amicus curiae is the one who assists the court by furnishing information or advice regarding questions of law or fact. The decision whether to admit the information given by amicus curiae lies with the discretion of the court. So this amicus curiae, the person, is not a party to the lawsuit and thus differs from an intervener. So when we say intervener, he or she has a direct interest in the outcome of lawsuit and is therefore permitted to participate as a party to the suit. On the other hand, amicus curiae won't have any interest in the lawsuit but tries to help the court by giving information or advice regarding the questions of law. For example, former Comptroller and Auditor General Vinod Rai has served as amicus curiae in this Padmanabha Swami Temple court case. Next, let us discuss one more term discussed in the news article, that is parens patriae, which means parent of his or her country. See, we all know that the state is regarded as a sovereign. Hence, state in its capacity is the provider of protection to those who are unable to take care of themselves. Here, parens patriae indicates the power of the state to act as guardian for those who are unable to care for themselves, such as children or disabled individuals. So in this context, know that all the deities, including idols, are considered perpetual minors and court has the parens patriae jurisdiction with reference to all the gods and deities in the country. Yes, this may look a little funny, but it is true. All the deities and idols are considered as minors and are unable to take care of themselves. So court serves as the guardian and so has the parens patriae jurisdiction over all the temples and deities. Next, let us see the doctrine of res subjudice. See, subjudice means under judgment. It can be said as a matter under consideration of a court or a judge. If you see, this doctrine of res subjudice aims to prevent courts of concurrent jurisdiction from simultaneously adjudicating upon two parallel litigations. This is different from res judicata. See, res judicata means once a matter is adjudicated or finalized, it cannot be re-adjudicated. It means if a matter has already been tried by a competent court, then trial between same parties in respect of same matter shall not be allowed. The difference between res subjudice and res judicata is, under res subjudice, two courts cannot adjudicate on the same topic which consists of same litigations and same litigants. On the other side, res judicata says that if a case is settled or adjudicated, it cannot be re-adjudicated. However, when there are merits or there are considerable changes in the facts and the realities, a case can be reopened and re-adjudicated. So this doctrine of res judicata is based on three principles. First, no man should be punished twice for the same cause, which is also present in fundamental rights, that is Article 20, which says that no double jeopardy. That is, no man should be punished twice for the same cause. Second, it is the interest of state that there should be an end to a litigation. And the final one, a judicial decision must be accepted as correct. So this is all about the important terms mentioned in the news article. We talked about amicus curiae, parens patriae, res subjudice, as well as res judicata. The practice question will be discussed at the end of session. We have arrived at the last segment of today's discussion, that is practice questions discussion. First question, with reference to National Security Advisor, consider the following statements. Statement 1. The post of NSA was created in the backdrop of 26/11 Mumbai terror attacks. No, this statement is incorrect. Know that the post of NSA was created in 1998 during the Prime Ministership of Atal Bihari Vajpayee. Statement 2. The Defence Planning Committee of India is chaired by National Security Advisor. Yes, this statement is correct. Statement 3. The NSA of India enjoys the cabinet rank. Yes, this statement is also correct. Previously, the NSA used to enjoy Minister of State rank, but in the recent past, it was upgraded to the cabinet rank. Therefore, the correct answer is option C, 2 and 3 only, since we are supposed to identify correct statement. Next question. Consider the following statements. Statement 1. Bailout is an arrangement in which creditors of a failing financial institution are required to cancel some of its debts as a part of plan to save it from collapse. Statement 2. Bail-in refers to external financial assistance to a failing financial institution to save it from collapse. If you see, both statements are incorrect. This is because the definitions of bail-in and bail-out are interchanged. See, bailout refers to external financial assistance, while bail-in refers to cancelling of a few liabilities. Here we are supposed to identify incorrect statements. Therefore, the correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2, since the both statements are incorrect. Next, consider the following statements. Statement 1. An amicus curiae is the friend of court who assists the court by furnishing information regarding questions of law or fact. Yes, the statement 1 is correct. Statement 2. The parens patriae jurisdiction indicates the power of the state to act as guardian for those who are unable to take care of themselves. Yes, statement 2 is also correct. Coming to statement 3. Doctrine of res judicata aims to prevent from simultaneously adjudicating upon two parallel litigations on same cause of action and subjects. No, this statement is incorrect because the statement 3 talks about res subjudice, while the res subjudicata means once matter is adjudicated, it cannot be re-adjudicated. So the statement 3 is incorrect. Therefore, the correct answer is option B, 1 and 2 only. Which among the following are stakeholders in electing or nominating members of the legislative council? First, members of local bodies in the state. 2. Graduates residing in the state. 3. Members of legislative assembly. 4. Governor of the state. Here if you see, all the 4 are correct. Therefore, the correct answer is option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Next, let us take up this practice mains question. What do you understand by the term political neutrality? How does one endorse political neutrality? This is a 10 marks question and the word limit is 150. So you can define political neutrality and you can give one or two examples. Dear aspirants, know that whenever you are writing an answer for GS4, examples play a vital role in getting good marks. So explain political neutrality and how can we endorse political neutrality with relevant examples. And here is one more question, which is a previous year mains question appeared on GS paper 2 in 2017. Initially, civil services in India were designed to achieve the goals of neutrality and effectiveness, which seems to be lacking in present context. Do you agree with the view that drastic reforms are required in civil services? Comment.
With this, we conclude today's news analysis. If you find this session resourceful, click on the like button, show your appreciation in the comment section, and don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Stay home, stay safe.